Ons sien uit na die sprekers en ja, ek glo ons gaan allemaal vandaag iets leer wat ons gaan help om ons genetische tendense enzovoorts te bevorder. So, baie dankie Jaapie. Ons sien uit na wat julle vir ons gaan sê en wat ons gaan leer by julle vandag.
Baie dankie Ras. Ek gaan net gou vinnig sê hoe die ding gaan verloop. Ek dink jy het sommer nog weer die program dalk gesien. What we did is we did some pre-recordings, those talks that Ross was were referring to. So we did ask the speakers to do pre-recordings of that. So we'll kick off by playing these pre-recordings. There's three of them. The first one would be Karina Visser from the University of Pretoria, Dr. Karina Visser, that will talk on genomics, what it is and what it's not. And then Prof. Scott Kluter from Elsenburg and University of Stellenbosch, the South African situation, what's happening in the genomic world for Marino. And then the way forward, which is a bit of a panel discussion that's also pre-recorded. Myself, Dr. Bernice Moster, Dr. Juliana Tron, Dr. Bobby van der Westhuizen, Dr. Bux Olivier, and Jason Redding. And that then once that's concluded, we'll have an open discussion for those who want to join in that. I think so. You're also then welcome to if you have any questions or contributions, to please jot it down and then we will allow for that. So die eerste een wat ons nou graag ek wil net miskien noem op hierdie stadium Ras en die res. Ons is nou op 48 deelnemers. Ek dink dis regtig dis 'n riem onder die hart dat ons so baie ons by mekaar kan kry vir so 'n sessie. So dis eintlik 'n goeie ervaring. So ek wil Bobby gaan vir my die beheer doen van die om hierdie vooraf opgeneemde gedeeltes te speel. So julle moet ook maar saam met ons is mens weet bietjie hoe werk Zoom en dan partykeer werk dit nie soos jy moet nie. So ons gaan deur die ding gaan. So Bobby, as jy miskien dan die eerste een van Karina asseblief vir ons kan reg kry en speel asseblief. Dankie.
Good afternoon. I'm Karina Visser from the University of Pretoria, Department of Animal Sciences. Today I'm going to share some thoughts on the topic of genomics. I will explain some of the principles and terminology that is associated with this technology. I will start by defining genomics, and then I will refer to the two main types of DNA markers that are commonly used in animal science worldwide. Of course, we have to refer to the application of these DNA markers respectively, because we can do different things with them. And I will also refer quickly to genomic selection, but this is a topic that will be addressed again later today, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. I will end with just briefly referring to some of the limitations that are very specific to the small stock industry. If you look at any journal or article that has anything to do with animal science, and that is from the Farmers Weekly right up to the very high impact international scientific journal, you will be confronted with the term genomics. It is a technology that has taken over the world, and it is specifically applied in animal science to a very large extent. And the reason for that is, of course, that it benefits the industry to a very large extent. There's so many different applications that can be done through genomics, but I'm just going to give a very brief overview of how genomics work and a few of the applications that we can use. So if we look at the scientific definition of genomics, it says that it is the science that promotes the understanding of genetics and gene functions in livestock and companion animals. So it means that we investigate the animal at a DNA level, the genes that express, so that is evident in the phenotype of the animal that we can see, that we can measure, and we for the first time really have a view into this DNA component of the animal. And we, of course, as animal scientists, want to apply this in terms of the health and the welfare of the animal, but also the production itself, the product quality, and the efficiency with which that production will take place. So it is something that really targets the whole animal and the whole production cycle. So it is a scientific definition. How do we actually do this? How do we get this view into the DNA of the animal? Well, it starts with a biological sample, and with that, we can use a blood sample, a fiber sample, hair or wool, as long as the follicle is still attached to that hair. It can be a tissue sample, semen sample, any of those. We crack open the cells within that sample and we extract the DNA from that. And the DNA is then sent to a certain laboratory so that it can be genotyped either with chips or microsatellites. And the results of that come back to a service provider or a scientist, and then it is analyzed to be applicable and usable by the farmer himself. So if we take a step back and we go back to the biological sample and we've cracked open the cells, what is within the cells is, of course, the genome of the animal, and in this case, the sheep genome. For sheep, it consists of 26 pairs of chromosomes and 2 sex chromosomes. And these chromosomes contain all of the nucleotides, those are the building blocks, and the genes that codes for specific traits that makes up the DNA of the animal. And it is important to note that this same genome and the same DNA material is present in every blood cell and every somatic cell of the animal's body. So when we take an ear tissue sample or a blood sample, or we pluck their hair with a follicle attached, we get the same DNA from all of those biological samples. Then we have the chromosomes. They are in a little tube after we've done the DNA extraction, and within those strings of DNA, they are made up of nucleotides. So it's basically 4 building blocks, A, C, T, and G, and they make up the complete genome from the very first to the very last chromosome. It is just a sequence of A, C, G, T's that are scrambled about, and that codes for all living organisms. So we have to infer something from this scattering and sequence of nucleotides. It is important to note that within a species, the ordering of the genome stays the same. So the information that is on the first animal's first chromosome will also be on the second animal's first chromosome. So specific genes and specific sequences are located on the same places in all of the population's genome. And for most of that genome, the animals are exactly the same. But there are certain spots within the genome that there are differences between animals. And those, the places where there are differences, are what we call DNA markers. Those are the spots that we want to exploit, because if one animal has an A nucleotide and another animal has a T nucleotide, that tells us something. So the DNA marker is a small region of DNA that shows variation, and the fact that it shows variation makes it a DNA marker. If you look at this picture, our 2 main types of DNA markers are depicted here. The pink one is a short tandem repeat, which is also known as a microsatellite marker. And then the SNP is a single nucleotide polymorphism. We will quickly have a look at those. The DNA marker in terms of a microsatellite is a short tandem repeat, and the name actually says exactly what it does. If you look at this yellow block, the GATA, that is a sequence that is repeated a certain number of times, and because the sequence is repeated, we call it a microsatellite. And if you look at these four individuals that are shown here, the first might be your first lamb, and then the second lamb, the third lamb, and the fourth lamb, and they all have different numbers of repetitive sequences. And that is the variation that we are looking for. That is the information that we can exploit. For SNPs, there is no repetitive sequence. A single nucleotide polymorphism means that at one specific point in the DNA, the animals will have different nucleotides. So here, sheep number one has a C nucleotide, while animal number two has a T nucleotide. Because a CG always links up and a TA always links up, you get these different combinations. But it is at one specific point in the DNA that these animals show variation. I'm going to focus on SNP chips, although we will come back briefly to the microsatellite. So we've said now that the SNPs are variants at a specific nucleotide position, as you can see on this picture here as well. And we find these SNPs very abundantly in the genomes of all of our mammals. So there are literally millions of these positions that there are variations between animals. But this SNP, because there are so many SNP locations, we cannot really investigate all of them. A million different positions will just be a totally overwhelming number of information to investigate. So what has been done is that SNP chips were developed, and a SNP chip has a specific number of these SNP locations that we investigate. If I can explain it in a very easy way to understand, I love this analogy, is that if you would sequence one animal, one sheep, that sequence of nucleotides will fill approximately 200 phone books that are 1,000 pages each. So you will have 200 of those phone books for every animal. And it is absolutely impossible to try and investigate that amount of information. It is just too much. So what the geneticists have done is to look at certain spots in the sequence where there is common variance. So we know at a certain spot that animals are prone to have C's and other animals are prone to have A's or G's or T's, whatever the case might be. And on a SNP chip, we only investigate those specific spots where we know variation will be apparent. So that might be anything from 15,000 spots on some of the SNP chips up to 600,000 SNPs on other SNP chips. We call those high density arrays. So the density of a SNP chip refers to the number of SNP locations that will be investigated in every animal. This is the way that the pipeline works to get to that number of variations. Is you have to take the biological sample. In this picture, it is an ear punch, and that tissue falls directly into a little tube so that there cannot be any contamination. The DNA is extracted, it is genotyped with a SNP chip, and once all that information comes back to the researcher or the service provider, it can be analyzed so that the breeder can use it in a sensible way. Now, if we return quickly to microsatellite markers as well as the SNPs, there is a difference in terms of the information that we get from these two different markers. If you take your biological sample and you send it to be genotyped with microsatellite markers, typically it won't be genotyped for more than 30 markers, and that is already a lot. For SNP chips, you've just seen, it will be more than 15,000 SNPs that are genotyped in the one go. So obviously, just makes sense that the genotyping with a microsatellite marker will be cheaper, while the SNP genotyping is more expensive. But you have to look at the value that you get from your genotyping as well. And with the microsatellite markers, they are mainly still used for parentage verification. I must say that although they are quite accurate, it is difficult when we have flocks or in specific species where there are bigger litter sizes, for instance. So as soon as there are twins and triplets within a population, it becomes a little bit more difficult to get accurate relationships. And we can also use this information to have very limited diversity estimates, so we can get an indication of the level of genetic diversity that is present in a specific flock. If we look at the SNP genotyping, because we get information from so many points across the genome, it gives us a very accurate relationship verification tool. We can also look at genetic diversity. We can estimate levels of inbreeding, which is, of course, very important. And then on most of these SNP chips, they include certain SNPs that are associated with genetic defects. So you only genotype your animal once, but you get a lot of information, including some diagnostic testing. And then, of course, the holy grail is to do genomic selection with that SNP genotyping. So this information can basically be partitioned into two main applications. And the first one will be what the farmer can use as a management tool in terms of parentage verification. If you make use of group mating to make sure that your sire is allocated to the right offspring and vice versa, we can do inbreeding estimation, and the farmer can have a very good idea of the rate of inbreeding that is happening on his farm, and then also to actually identify the carriers of genetic disorders that appear normal, but they do carry those disorders, and in some of the lambs, it will of course be expressed. On the other hand, we have genetic improvement, and that is where the genomically enhanced breeding values come in. So I must say that for the use, for the application of GEBVs and genomic selection, we still need phenotypes, we need accurate and complete pedigrees, and if we have that together with the SNP genotyping, the service provider can calculate a GEBV. This will result in a shorter generation interval and faster genetic improvement. This is a very simplified way of looking at genomic selection. The idea is that you first have to have a reference population in which all of the animals have accurate phenotypes. They have been genotyped typically at a high density, and we include all of that information together with complete pedigree information, and that is your baseline population, which is used to estimate a prediction equation. And once you have that prediction equation, Dr. Bobby will expand on that, once you have that for a specific trait, you can genotype a very young animal that has not yet expressed a trait, but you can already estimate a genomically enhanced breeding value for that animal without a phenotypic record. And that is done with a high level of accuracy, so the accuracy of selection will improve and the generation interval will shorten. Please take note that the benefits of genomic selection is highest for those traits that are typically very difficult to select for and that is difficult to make genetic progress for. So the traits that have low heritability estimates, traits that are only expressed in one of the sexes, traits that are only expressed later in the animal's life, and also traits that are difficult or expensive to measure. For instance, carcass traits where you have to sacrifice the animal before you can get the phenotypic information. Then I just quickly want to refer to a few of the limitations that we have in the small stock industry in terms of genomics. And I think it is a fact that there's been less investment in sheep and goat research, and that is across the world. I know my colleagues in the USA have the same problems as we do. So there is less investment in general. That has an impact on the development of SNP chips and all of the scientific technology that underlies this. Then in South Africa, we of course have a problem with a limited number of animals with highly accurate EBVs, especially for hard to measure traits. And we need accurate phenotypes to establish that reference population to be able to apply genomic selection. Another problem is, of course, the financial investment that is necessary from whoever is the funder, whether it's the government or the farmer himself, the relative cost of genotyping to the cost of the animal is much higher for small stock than for cattle, for instance, and that poses a problem. And all of these contribute to the difficulty in establishing a reference population for genomic selection. But Dr. Bobby and the other speakers will expand on some of these principles that I have referred to. I hope you have found this relevant and informative. And if you have any questions, I will be available at the Q&A session at the end of these presentations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Karina, for that informative present the recordings. But otherwise, we can carry on with the next recording, and that is Professor Skalk Kluter, and Skalk's talk will more about what's happening in the genomic world of merino, and he's going to give us a glimpse into what's happening elsewhere, and maybe also on the research front with genomics in merino specifically. So.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a privilege to be able to talk to you under the slightly interesting situation that we're living in. My topic for today is the South African situation, what is happening in the genomic world for merinos. I'm Skalk Kluter, and I'm talking on behalf of the Owen Genomics Working Group. Now, you could see in preparing this preparation, I stood on the shoulders of giants because I work with quite potent people. So there's people from research institutes like Elsenburg and Grootfontein, universities from Stellenbosch, Free State and Pretoria, co-workers like Dr. Olivier, service providers, as well as international guests like people from the Animal Genetics and Breeding Unit and the University of New England, Western Australia Department of Agriculture. To give an overview of what I'm going to say, I'm going to provide some background, then I'm going to talk a bit about biobanks, about the humble beginnings of the project, then I'm going to pose a few questions. Do genomics tell us about performance, and how do our resources relate internationally? Then I'm going to talk a bit about the way ahead. Now, as a bit of a background, I think all will agree that we live under conditions of rapid technological advantages, and animal breeding is no exception to this rule. And we know that pedigree blood methods served us very well for many years. But the thing about pedigree-based blood is that it used the average of the sire and the dam, and used that to predict the breeding value of the offspring. Genomic methods actually has the actual genotype of the offspring of and may thus be able to give better predictions of the genetic merit of an animal. It all starts with biobanks, because we know that all marker systems are based on the DNA of animals. This can be used for conservation, for pedigree verification, for breed identification, and also for selection. and for other applications too. It's important to have samples of important animals for this purpose, and it is important to store these animals as close to possible under optimal conditions, because the last thing that you would like to happen is to have an animal that is really informative and you only find out that you cannot use its DNA. And for this reason, Biobanks was established at Grootfontein and at Elsenburg. I think that Greta Stemman should get a lot of credit for foresight in getting the Grootfontein Biobank up and running. When we look at the Grootfontein Biobank and that wool sheep, you can see there's about 27,000 blood samples stored there, of which about 2,200 have been genotyped already. And when you look at the Elsenburg Biobank, there is another about 9,000 animals, of which about 700 have been genotyped, which adds up to give us about 36,000 blood samples and about 3,000 genotypes. When we look at the sheep genotype to date according to breed, we have got our 2,000 merinos, then about 650 dunis, some Esmont merinos, Dormers and the Frinos. Now, to conclude about biobanks, we have samples of appreciable numbers of animals, and the vast of majority of these animals also have records, and because of that, it is a valuable resource. They do have resource flock animals as well as industry animals, and the resource flock animals generally have more traits recorded, but industry animals are more representative of what is actually happening in the industry. And I think it is fair to conclude that these resources is of great potential value for future research as well as for breed improvement. Just a bit about our humble beginnings. And in 2000, everybody was looking for genetic markers for that bit of DNA that would really get you a huge effect of your, that would give you a huge boost in your genetic progress. Some were actually found, but they rarely made a huge difference in production. And then, as Karina said, the Owen Stipp 50K genotyping platform became available, and the project was launched to assess its application to our sheep in South Africa. And yes, we could get our breeds to cluster separately. So we can see the merinos over here, Dunis, Esmont merinos, Dorpers and Dormers, and everything was hunky-dory. But this is more about generating pretty pictures. I think we have to start thinking about how we could apply it. And for this, I'm going to get the indication of how genotypes actually was related to performance. And some of you may know about the Elsenburg selection line. So in this graph, we have got years on this axis. And then we have got predicted breeding value of number of lambs weaned on this axis. And some of you might know that the experiment actually involved up and down selection. So there was a high line selected in the upwards direction and a low line that was selected in the downward selection. And I actually got quite a lot of flack for this downward selected line because people just said, you can't do that. It doesn't make sense to select downwards. But what we were able to do is we were able to generate quite a lot of diversity that could be used if you could find genetics associated with it. You can see that in the last few years, there's actually quite a difference between the high line up here and the low line down here. I could just say that these graphs are the progeny of industry animals that we got from you for the first reason to link these animals to industry and then also to make sure that we don't have a lot of inbreeding in these animals. So we actually have a fair genetic difference between the animals. Now it remains to be seen to what extent this can be explained by the genomic information that we have. What Nelius Nell, one of my students, did is he created this Manhattan plot. Now, it's called a Manhattan plot because it has got this kind of look like a city skyline with skyscrapers of all shapes and sizes on the horizon. And you can see there are snips from 1 to about 50,000, and then they are separated according to chromosome 1, 2, 3, and etc. And what Nelius did is in this red line, he had a smoothing algorithm that they used a number of SNPs at the time. And he used it to predict where there was signs of selection that was practiced in these lines. And the threshold for significance was actually this black line. So you can see there were strong signals of selection here at chromosome 2, and then also at chromosome 5, and then also at chromosome 8. And when we look at the SNPs associated there, it is interesting to look that over the whole genome, there were actually SNPs that was basically also showing signs of being under selection. So it shows that the animals differed a lot genetically, and this graph would like to suggest that some of these differences might be explained by the genomic constitution of the animals. The second example I'm going to talk about is an experiment done by Karina Visser and Greta Steinman, one of their students, and they used the Wolseby Dooney Merino flock for this. They had basically three genetic clusters, and this cluster three was a cluster that was quite resistant. You can see it has got a much lower fecal worm count than cluster two and cluster four. And so what we did is we put them on a graph as well. And so you can see that it looked like a bit like this. So you can see this green bit is the Grootfontein Dooney Merino flock. So it's kind of not applicable right here. But you can see that the cluster 3 is situated down here, and then cluster 2 and cluster 4 down here. So you can see, again, that there is some differentiation according to the cluster that have been identified up here. Do genomics tell us about performance? Yeah, no, I think we could conclude that it does contribute to our understanding of the loci affecting the quantitative traits. And it supports the notion that genomic information may play a role in our prediction of the genetic merit of animals. The only thing that we have to note is that there's many loci with relatively small effects that might underlay quantitative. And this makes marker-assisted selection challenging because there's simply too many markers to be selected for. So it's fair to recommend that we should continue data generation and do further studies on a genomic basis for quantitative traits. And this could be either genome-wide dissociation scans, of which several studies are underway, or else the genomic estimated breeding values, which Sarin Satuk is working on with other role players as well. The next question I would like to pose is, how do our resources relate internationally? For this, we collaborated with Australian people. The reason is they have got a similar sort of climate and farming landscape. We've got overlapping breeds. They are the biggest apparel wool producer. We're also big on that. We're the second biggest. And they are further down at the track with genomic selection. And they also have the willingness to become involved. Now, if we look about where Australia is right now. So when we were creating our first graphs around about 2013, they were actually releasing genomic breeding values for eating quality traits in their performance recording scheme. In 2017, it was followed up by single-step carcass analysis on 17 traits, and in 2017, they moved to a full single-step analysis. Now, if you look at the genotyping of Merino specifically, you can see years are on this axis, and you can see the information nucleus flock, which is a number of research flocks that is situated over Australia. And they have been steadily genotyped over the past few years, and you can see they reached, let's say, around about 10,000 genotypes recently. But then this purple bit is genotypes that is provided by industry. So it means that industry people wanted to genotype the animals themselves. And you can see it was quite steady at first, but it just skyrocketed in the last few years. So the implication is that people in industry realized that it might assist them in their selection decision. And because of that, they decided to invest in genotypes. And if you just compare, you can see the Australians are up there at above 40,000 genotypes for their merinos. We still have about 2,000 genotypes, so we have about 5% of the genotypes that they would have available. Now, when we look at sheep recording in Australia, sheep genetics Australia caters for a number of breeds, including terminal breeds, maternal breeds, as well as merinos. Now, in New Zealand, there is a similar kind of service being offered by Sheep Industry Limited. But since New Zealand mostly have Romney and Romney-based breeds and then also terminal breeds, the New Zealand merino farmers don't always feel comfortable in this mix of breeds. And therefore, they contribute their data to sheep genetics Australia as well. So one could conclude that South Africa, New Zealand, Merino, and Australia shares a common interest in apparel wool breeds. The question is then, could South Africa share in the progress made overseas and specifically in Australia? And for this, we see to what extent we could predict our genotypes using Australian information. And this is other work that Nelius did. So he basically had 50,000 SNP genotypes of a few breeds, including Meatmaster, some Dormers, Esmat Merinos, Dooney Merinos, Merinos, Dorpers, and White Dorpers. And what he did is he took the 50,000 markers of each animal, he cut it down to 15,000, in other words, 1/5, that occur on the low density chip at that stage. And then he used Australian information to build it up to 50,000 SNPs again. And then he just correlated the original genotype with the genotype that he got by going through these steps. And well, the Australians don't have anything quite like the Meatmaster. So in other words, the prediction he got wasn't so good. They also don't have anything quite like the Dormer, so it wasn't reliably predicted as well. They do have some Esmat Merinos and some Dooney Merinos. And I could just point out that here at around 88% is what they call where you can quite reliably use data that is predicted in this way in genomic evaluation. And the merinos always almost reach that level at about 87. The dormers was about just the dorpers was about just on it, and the white dorpers actually exceeded it. So it seems like Australian information can be used to quite reliably predict least in merino types and in the dorpers, which I think is good for us. And then Nelius also put all the animals in a plot like this, and you can see Australia has got circles and South Africa has got triangles. So you can see all the merinos are lying over here. So the green ones are the South African merinos. You can see there's some triangles and some circles. Then we have got Dooney Merinos and Esmat Merinos. You can also see in there, is also some circles and triangles. Then we've got Dormers with just triangles because Australia don't have anything like that. And then Dorpers where there is some circles and some triangles. And then the Dorsets, you could at least the pole Dorsets. And South Africa don't have any of them. But though our focus is on this, on the merino breed. So in other words, I'm going to zoom in specifically on that. So what we have here is we've got in red, we've got the Elsmerk animals. Then in yellow, we've got the Grootfontein animals. The industry animals are these green ones. So you can see some of them cluster with Elsmerk and some of them also cluster with Grootfontein. Then we have got these kind of deep red ones, the Cradock fine wool flock. And then we've got the Australian animals. So this is the super fine Australian bloodline. This is the fine medium 2 bloodline in Australia. A bit further off is the fine medium 1 bloodline in Australia. And the Australian strong wool sheep is actually there quite a bit separately. But so the nice thing is to see that many of these animals are actually quite closely. So you can say that they kind of belong together in a way. So when we put all this information in sort of a tree to see what is happening, you could see that in South Africa, the industry and Grootfontein animals are more or less on one branch, and then they are joined on that branch by the Elsenberg animals. Then a bit further back, there's a branch that leads to the ultrafine and the Cradock animals. And just know the ultrafine Australian animals is lying here with Cradock. And a bit further down the road, we have the fine medium 2 bloodline in Australia. And then also we have the strong bloodline as well as the fine medium one bloodline. So I think it is important to note that the ultra fine bloodline was actually quite close to Cradock and quite far away from some of the other Australian bloodlines, I think, which is quite good for us. So as a way of talking about the way ahead, the Australian genotypes predicted quite accurately from merinos and dorpers, and dorpers probably benefited from imports from the same commercial source that we have also genotyped. And the breeds also clustered together closely, indicating that they are still quite related, even though the merinos and the Australian merinos hasn't had that much contact in the recent years. And the ultra-fine bloodline was closer to Cradock than to some of the Australian bloodlines. And this relatedness could be used to good effect under certain conditions. I would like to contend that we can move ahead by sharing resources with Australia, and that local buyers can breeders can benefit by buying into the idea of obtaining genotypes of their own sheep. I would like to stress that this is no silver bullet that is not going to cure all your problems, but that worthwhile gains is likely to occur eventually. And this quest may benefit from good collaboration within the South African research groups, as well as with our international collaborators. And I think this is my story. So I would like to finally thank especially the Funderscape Wools Trip, Redmeat Research and Development, as well as the Western Cape Agricultural Research Trust. And that is my story. Okay, bye.
Thank you very much, Skalk, for that. I'm sure there's a little bit of some cats amongst the pigeons, so it will be interesting once we get to the Q&A session and the discussion session. The last pre-recording was done, it's in a sense a panel discussion, not a panel discussion, but a presentation, short presentations by different authors. And also a short discussion with Bux Olifield. Bux cannot be with us today, so we hooked him in for that discussion as well. The first presentation will be by Bernice Mostert. Just sort of some practicalities as to how to what to do next for genomic testing genomics in small stock in sheep specifically.
Thank you, Yabi. So I'll begin right at the beginning of genomic testing, and that is how the samples should be taken. There's different samples that you can send in for genotyping. Probably the best sample that can be taken is blood by drawing blood from the animals in test tubes, the test tubes with the purple lids, but it's however a little bit difficult to do this, and also these samples need to be kept on ice at around 4 degrees centigrade up to delivery. You can also put blood onto specialized blood cards, which is much more easy to manage, and you can also send in semen as a straw, or you can also drip semen onto the same blood cards that we use for the blood. And you can also send in ear clippings in paper bags, not in plastic bags. It should be in paper bags. This is actually a very nice way of sampling your animals, because if you take out a triangular sample in the ears of the sheep, it's easy to see which sheep already has been sampled for genotyping and which were not. Remember always, when working with biological material, beware that there's not contamination between samples of different animals. Now, these samples should then be sent to SA Statbook, clearly indicating that it is for small stock genomic testing, and the address will then be Henry Street, 118 Westin, Bloemfontein, 9301. Now, the paper envelopes and the blood cards can also be obtained directly from SA Statbook. Looking at the workflow from where the samples, the process of the samples, The breeder will take the samples on the farm. Those samples are then sent to SA Studbook. At SA Studbook, the samples are verified against the information that we have on logics of the animal and of the breeder. And the samples are then recorded on SA Studbook genomic tracking system. From there, it is sent to the laboratory where the DNA is being extracted and the genotyping then occurs. Those results are then sent back to SA Studbook as electronic files, where it is then uploaded onto our genomic database. The results are being processed. The genomic information are included in our genetic evaluations for the estimation of genomically enhanced breeding values. And those information are then uploaded onto SA Studbook's logic system. All animals that has been genotyped will be flagged or are flagged with this genotyped logo. And then the genomic information are also sent back to our farmers as genomic reports. When you decide to do genomic selection, which of your animals should be genotyped? With regards to genetic progress on a breed basis, and even in a flock basis, the most important animals to be genotyped will be those that will potentially have many offspring. By doing this, you establish a much more reliable system of selection for the breed, and you also contribute to the genomic reference population of the next generation. If you are a stud breeder and you are quite high up in the ranking, genetic ranking of the breed, it will benefit you to genotype all your young animals, therefore improving the reliability with which the animals will be selected, and thereby significantly improving the rate of genetic progress that you will achieve in your flock. If you're in a situation where there's a lot of unknown parentages for your animals, you can benefit quite a lot by genotyping your animals because all these unknown parentages can be resolved. However, you need to genotype the animals as well as all the other animals that are potential parents. By doing this, the genetic level of your herd can be very accurately established within the breed. This is probably the biggest benefit of genomic selection for our small stock breeds. If you introduce new rams into your flock, it is really very wise to genotype these rams, especially if information on them are very sparse. By doing that, you can much more accurately select the rams that will fit your flock. And you can establish if connectiveness will be improved by the rams that you select. Also, inbreeding can be much more accurately be determined and managed by genotyping the animals. Even flocks that are in upgrading systems can benefit from genotyping as the breed compositions of all the animals can be established, thereby increasing the rate of the upgrading situation of the flock. Yavi, that's all from me.
Thanks, Bernice. We would then like to continue our discussion, and I would like to ask my colleague Elena Tron. Elena will just talk briefly on the advantages that this technology will have for the users of the technology. Thank you, Elena.
Good day, everybody. I am going to talk about the advantages that this genomics would have for breeders. Basically, the advantages that breeders will have from genomic analysis is, like previous speakers said, more accurate parentages. Because it's done on many more markers than traditionally. We can also detect some of the single genes that is in sheep. And then we could have more accurate breeding values, especially for the difficult traits that are measured late in an animal's life or only on 1-6, things like fertility, maternal traits, and longevity. There's also the possibility of new traits, things that we have always knew are genetically influenced, but it's difficult to measure. Traits like adaptability, some disease resistance, and wool and meat quality traits. If we look at parentages, this is a slide from Donna Berry that was done in Ireland, and they found that the sire offspring errors are actually quite remarkable. In sheep, they found around 13% of parentages were recorded incorrectly. Here's just an example as well of these of a group of half sibs, but it's clear that these sibs don't have the same sire as those ones. So these parentage will be picked up much more correctly than with ordinary recording. Some of the single genes that can be tested for, hopefully they are not all present in our sheep herds. The salipage gene, this is a normal sheep, so it gives these beautiful buttocks tested for. Spider lamb syndrome, most of the genes are for fertility or infertility. And then the yellow fat gene as well. So here's a more complete list of it. I'm not sure, it doesn't seem that they can test for the pole gene at this stage. I know poleness is, the inherited is a bit difficult in the merino. So one of the other advantages is more or better, more accurate EBVs at an earlier age. So where you currently have EBVs, you will now have genomically enhanced EBVs or GEBVs. So the EBVs of today is a combination of pedigree and performance. So for GEBV, SNPs is added. The process of estimating breeding values is single step GBLAB, and then you get GEBVs. The GEBVs looks exactly the same as the EBVs that you have today. There's nothing is going to be different. We will just flag the animals that have a genomic analysis as well. This animal, the parentage is also tested positive for both the sire and the dam. So how does this more accurate breeding values work? I have an example here of Bonsmora where they have been getting GEBVs for a number of years. And you can see if you plot the breeding values, the EBVs versus the GEBVs, you can see the GEBVs has changed the EBVs slightly. If you plot the accuracies against the genomic accuracies, you can see that the lower the accuracy, the higher the G accuracy is, and all these accuracies has improved. And so the GEBV gives you the breeding value or the breeding merit of the animal at an earlier age. This is where the EBV is going to end up. So with the GEBV, you just get it at a younger age. The same effect at with cow fertility. It has increased the accuracy quite a bit, and the breeding values look a bit different as well. But if you look at wean direct, where the accuracies of this group of animals were already reasonably accurate, so there is not so much of a difference. And you can see even on the breeding values versus the GEBVs, there's not so great a difference that there is. Because weaning weight is measured on the animal itself at a reasonably early stage. So it is accurate and where it's going to be very much faster than the previous traits that I've shown you. If we look at the progeny equivalent numbers, how many measured animals do you need to be equivalent to one genomic test? You can see it's well worth your while to do the genomic tests. Here's the weaning weight. And it's around 14 animals, 12 to 14 animals to is the same weight as one genomic test. These traits, it's a bit lower. This is on New Zealand data. Number of lambs born, it's a great advantage to do an equivalent genomic test rather than, we still need to measure all the animals, but this will, at a much earlier stage, your one genomic test will count as much as having been measured between 9 and 27 animals. Other advantages, you can determine breed purity. You can determine genetic connectedness between herds. You can estimate the genomic inbreeding as well. And there are new programs that you can control the genomic inbreeding with which animals you put together, which is could also be a very good thing. And then there's the novel traits for wool and wheat quality traits. And in the literature, you get a lot of diagrams like this. This is for skin traits in the merino, and it's the relatedness between the different SNPs that they have with on one another. So I think we're in for interesting times, and a lot of new research is being done. Thank you, Pjopi, back to you.
Thanks very much, Ileana. I think what's being shown here by Ileana is it's all about what's been said earlier on to determine as early as possible in an animal's life their so-called Mendelian sampling. So what sample of good or bad genes it got from its parents or even from the grandparents. So that's the objective. The one way of doing that is to record the progeny of an animal, but the other way of doing that is, and that's where all these equivalents come in, where you needed maybe 10 or 15 or whatever progeny being recorded by doing a genomic test at a very young age of an animal, you can determine that that Mendelian sampling. So what, did it get good or bad sample of genes from its parents? As this is part of the panel discussion, Bobby will now present to us how genomic information is used or utilized in the blood breeding value presentation. Like I said, this is a panel discussion, and please also jot down your questions, as the panelists will be available after this recording as well. So Bobby, you can go ahead to present this for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yapi. I just gonna quickly just show you how the genomic information is being utilized or taking up into the genetic evaluations and what actually happened to the genomic information. So as you all know, that unfortunately most of economical important traits that we used to select on or in farm animals is quantitative of nature. This means that the majority of these economical traits are being influenced by the environment, of course, and also that it is controlled by a number of genes. So basically, that what you see or measure on the farm is actually a product of the genetic makeup of the animal, as well as the environment in which the animal has been evaluated or measured. And this is very important to know, because what we need to do is we need to remove the environmental effect from the genetic effect, so that we know which animals are the best suitable animals to be used as the future parents of the flock. So all of us know how BLOP work. BLOP genetic evaluation, there's three very important blocks or building blocks for running a genetic evaluation. Of course, the first thing is the herd book. So you need a herd book to make genetic linkages between animals and to see which animals are related to which animals. We need performance measurements. That means performance testing measurements to slot to be used in blob analysis. And then the third thing that we need is so-called heritabilities or genetic parameters to know which trait is, what is the heritability of each trait and what is the genetic correlations between them. And these three blocks are used basically to define a genetic evaluation program to get breeding values for animals. So what differs from this traditional blob model with the inclusion of genomic information? So what basically happens is that we take the pedigree information part of the model and we add the genomic or SNP information within the herd book information. And then where traditional, we only have used the animal, the sire, the dam, the sire, the sire of the sire, the sire of the dam of the sire of the dam, and the dam of the dam, and so forth and so forth. We now can actually go and we can slot in the specific the gene makeup of the animal based on the SNP information within this herd book information, and then we get a new relationship matrix which is enhanced by the genetic relationship on the SNP, on the physical gene makeup of the animal. So the what you can see, we still need the performance measurements, we still need the heritabilities and the genetic parameters, and the only thing that changes is that we use the genomic information together with the herd book information in the blob analysis. And this is called a so-called single step G-blob analysis that we use, and that enhanced the accuracy of especially young animals, which is not measured for a specific trait. Thank you, Yapi.
Thank you, Bobby, for that. The last talk of this discussion is by Jason. Jason will just enlighten us on where we are currently with the, how far we've progressed with the genetic evaluation for Merino, where we include the genomic information in Merino sheep. So Jason, you can start, get going with your screen being shared, and then the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Yapi. Hello everyone. I'll just be talking about the Merino genotypes, the data that we physically have at as of this moment. So we at SA Studbook, we've received four different batches of SA Merino genotypes. We had first three batches, A, B, and C, were all done on the original ovine SNP50K chip, version one. And looking at the quality of those genotypes, they were all of a good quality, between 90 and about 95%. Then we had batch D, by far the largest batch of 1,106 profiles, and they've all been done on the most recent version of the SNP chip, the version 2 ovine SNP chip. And all of these were of great quality in terms of the profile, in terms of the number of markers, over 98% of all the markers were being caught. So in total, we had about 1,411 Merino genotypes. We've updated all of them regarding to the most recent build that is available, as well as the fact that after doing a little bit of investigation, there's a high compatibility between the two chips, meaning that we are able to use both sets of batches in order to predict genomic breeding values. So with the preliminary investigation, we excluded 46 animals from batch A because the data set that was given was incoherent with regards to batches B, C, and D. And then after we matched the animals in those files with the animals that are registered in the Logix blob files, we were able to correctly match 1,356 animals across five different flocks. And these were broken up into 49 males and 1,307 females. There we go. after the so animals were unable to be matched because of one of the following reasons: either that animal was not registered on Logix and there's no record of that animal, so I could not match that animal. An incorrect sex was given, and that was one of the big problems with batch A. So because the sex on the given file was different from that on what is on Logix, we decided to exclude it, as well as certain animals had duplicate animal IDs. So this brings on to that emphasis that there needs to be correct animal identification on the samples given when those animals are genotyped. And then animals are excluded from the further downstream genomic analysis due to either they are unmatched in the dry lab after they were genotyped, or that there was a poor quality in the genomic profile, which would be due to the wet lab, and maybe they were unable to extract DNA. What's next in the step in our process that we are going? We are going to be incorporating these genotypes into our blood genetic evaluation, and then we'll be assessing these genomically enhanced breeding values to see if they correlate with what is currently going on within the population. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jason, for that contribution. So obviously we're all looking forward to the next step to release the first batch of GBVs for the breed from now on. Okay, I don't know if there are any discussion amongst the panelists here. Bix, you were patiently waiting on the side, and you also said you're probably going to contribute, maybe not in English, but that's fine with me. And the rest of the panelists, I don't know if there are specific issues or maybe a contribution that you would like to make for this.
Okay, I've got three things to add to. The first thing is the paper bag, the ear clip that go into the paper bag. I think this is a very, very great thing to do, because you can take your sample of your rams that you use and keep it with you. And say, for instance, over 3 or 4 years, you decided to do genomics, then you can just take out that bag and so on. So I'll encourage all breeders, if you don't do genomics or not plan to do it, just take a sample and keep it in a paper bag. You can even store it somewhere, but please keep it, because if the animal is dead, it's dead. The second thing I want to stress is the numbers. Now, when you take the sample, don't use the name of the ram or whatever, because I've struggled in the past very with trying to figure out who's Puna and who's new Puna and who's claim Puna and all that thing. So please put the full number on the sample. That means this is your head designation mark plus the year and the number of the animal. And then the last thing, I will encourage young breeders. You know, the big problem with entering into blood is the base population. So your blood values is not very good when you start off due to the base population, due to lack of linkages. So for young breeders starting, use genomics to get your base population sorted out, and also in the same time get better linkages with other known studs and so on. But I think all these things is currently not it's not a very expensive exercise, but it will be a good it will be a good belegging for the future.
Investment.
Investment for the future, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Bix, for that contribution as well. I think we can, this then concludes this panel, the discussion or this presentation, and we can then carry on with the rest of our meeting. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much for that. I don't know, I would like to open up the floor if there are anybody who wants to contribute or a question or maybe just a comment. You're more than welcome. Bobby has muted everybody at the moment, so if you want to speak out, please just unmute yourself and then we can maybe have a discussion. We still, I think, 50 people on board, which is amazing. For the whole time, we stayed between 48 and 50 people on this. So I don't know if there are any contributions or question anywhere. Okay, Yvette, the cost, Yvette, would be in rand value in the region. Bobby, you must just correct me. I think it's in the region of about 700 to 800 rand currently per genotype.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
Yapi, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, I think the progress is encouraging because it, for a while, genomics sort of was, particularly in the sheep side, was pretty stagnant. So I think the fact that we are now starting to use the Australian work because there's enough of a fit is moving us along. So I'm quite excited about it. I suppose I'm just watching for how this test phase that you guys are busy with is going to pan out. The challenge will always be that I don't think people are going to, even at these costs, which are relatively quite a lot reduced from when we started speaking about this, whether people are going to be typing a lot of U's. I can see sires being typed, but it will be questionable of how many of the females are going to be.
Yes, Jeff, that's exactly what we found with beef cattle as well. With dairy, sometimes the females are worth a little bit more. But with beef cattle, potential herd sires are usually being genotyped, and we see that more often now at sales as well because of trait like maternal, wean maternal and female fertility is becoming more and more important. So some herd sires are being done, but fewer females are being genotyped. Aksien, ek dink is Marie de Wies wat vra oor die kans vir kruiskontaminasie by oortnip. Ek weet nie, skalk julle ouens wat nou bietjie meer met genotipes werk of Greta. Ek seker daar is natuurlik 'n goeie kans dat as jy nie tussen twee diere sorg dat daar nie biologiese materiaal oorbly op die tang dat daar 'n probleem kan wees. Ek weet nie of iemand anders kan dalk kommentaar op dit lewe in die skaak of Greta of miskien van die telers wat Willem lewens ook op wat miskien bietjie meer ondervinding het.
Ja, ek kan net sê Skak,
vinnig. Ja.
Wag, ek gaan my video ook aanset dat julle kan sien dat ek hier is.
Ja.
Ek kan net sê dat die mense die stelsel wat jy knippie kry is actually steriel soort van. So want jy kry soort van die tangetjie en daar's 'n bolletjie onderaan en jy vat die monster en jy sit die monster onder die bolletjie. Jy sit 'n nuwe bolletjie aan, steriliseer jy besigheid en neem jou volgende monster. Dis soos ek het onthou, Greta, ek weet jy kan gerus inkom en dan net sê as jy miskien iets anders weet daarvan. Maar so met ander woorde, ek dink nie die kans van contaminatie is so goed nie. Dit werk eigenlijk heel goed. En net na aanleiding van die genotypering van oeie of ramme, ek dink die ondervinding is dat in die algemeen, in die eerste ruk is daar oeie gegenotypeer, omdat hulle reproduseer en omdat daar dus dood eenvoudig, daar is op die stadium min werklik betekenisvolle ramme beskikbaar as mens begin met so besigheid. En daarom begin jy maar deur oeie te genotipeer en dan nou die ramme wat baie gebruik word en dan later, naarmate jy aangaan in die stelsel, begin jy al meer en meer rammel genotypeer wat, want jy het nou al, jy weet, die basis vir genotypes, so met ander woorde, mens kan dit op die manier dan structureer. Oké, ek dink dis is my story.
Ja, ek sien, Yvette het gereageer, en dankie Karina, jy ook oor die methode wat beskikbaar is, wat een mens kan gebruik in Suid-Afrika. Ek dink Greta's, ja. Greta, ja, asseblief.
Ja, ek wil net sê, ek stem saam, wat Karina ook nou gesê het, daar, en ek dink sy het ook op een van haar skyfies gewys, dit is een sekere applicator wat jy kry, en dan, en wat soos Kaap ook genoem het, die oorknip val in die buisie in, maar dan het vir elke liewe, vir elke skaap is daar individuele, sê maar, een naald wat die stikkie oor uitpunch. So dis nie jou gewone tektang wat jy vat en een oorknip maak nie. Dit gaan nie werk nie. Ek kan jou garantie, dit gaan nie werk nie. Want jy sal dading moet met alcohol of iets moet ontsmet tussen elke oorknip. Ek weet nie van enige systeem wat die mense gewone oortek gebruik nie. Al die oorseese mense wat ook, sê maar, die oorknippe laat instuur, hulle gebruik die basis wat jy krijg, soos Karina ook gesê, is in Suid-Afrika beskik, waar ek weet, sy het die besonderhede daarvan. Dit sal werk. Wat ek ook wel gevra het, hoe lang kan jy die oorknip hou, as jy hem net so in die koevertjie sit? Want die basis het een of ander middel in, om die oor, sê maar, te preserveer. So, hoe lang gaan hy hou, as jy hem net in die koevertjie sit? Het julle enige inligting daar oor?
Ja, ek het ongelukkig nie, ek het op een stadium met Unistel gepraat, dat hulle praat dat dit goed is om bykie sout te gebruik, ook om as een preserveermiddel, maar ek sou toch ook bang wees om dit te lang, jy weet, so te hou, Greta, ek weet nie hoe lang sy my.
Ja, want self die basis het, het van die goed het ek gekyk het, die basis moet jy ook binnen een sekere tydperk moet jy die DNA uithaal. Jy kan die basis ook nie vir jare hou nie. Dis ook om ons met die bloed werk. Die bloed kan jy langer hou.
Ja, die bloed vat net, jy weet, het bevriesing nodig en ja, het is reg. Karina?
Ja, ek wil gesê, ek het precies dieselfde bekommernis as Greta gehad, aangaande die oorknippe wat net somme ook met die gewone tang gedoen word, want dan is die kans op contaminatie uiteraard baie hoog. En ook om hierdie oorweefsel net so in een sakkie te wil stoor vir jare. Ons het al gesien hoe vinnig DNA kan degradeer en die kwaliteit so laag raak dat men eintlik niks meer daarmee kan doen nie. So ek dink is belangrijk om die regte toerusting te gebruik. Die buise wat kom saam met die regte, die ponsmachientjie waarvan Greta gepraat het, die tang, het alreeds een buffer in. En omdat hy die buffer in het, val die stukkie weefsel direct daarin en hy word gepreserveer. Nie vir oneindige tyd nie, maar daarom vir een langer tydperk. Vir maande, party mense praat van 'n paar jaar. So ek sou voorstel, voordat mens net sommer links en rechts begin oorknip, dat mens net seker maak jy gebruik die regte toerusting, anders sit jy dalk met biologiese materiaal wat heeltemal onbruikbaar is. Dankie.
Goed, hier is een vraag oor die lab om te gebruik. Tans, behalwe op experimentele vlak, is die enigste laboratorium wat genomies op een commerciële skaal doen, is Unistel. Dit moet nie, as jy weer miskien gaan kyk na Karina's aanbieding, oor die verskil tussen, ek wil amper sê die traditionele manier van ouerskappe en so aan, en genomika of waar ons op die SNP paneel werk, tans is daar eintlik net een lab, boonbehalwe nou die platform of 'n paar experimentele laboratoria, wat dit op 'n commerciële skaal doen. Dis hoekom ons wil aanbeveel, as het moontlik is om het deurstamboek te doen, dan kan ons ook dit aanteken en het dan vir die lab stuur. As dit
het hulle ook een sekere minimum, ek skies, sekere wat jy moet doen. Ek dink Manro het laatst gesê, dis iets so 96 monsters.
Bobby, jy kan miskien net sê, want dis een sogenaamde, dis mos een klomp snips op een wafer of so iets, en ek is nie seker nie.
Die snip het 96 wells.
Ja, 96. Ja, so dit is so, Greta, as jy instuur en jy moet wacht vir een paar ander ouwens, dan gaan jy bietjie wacht tot die batch opgemaak word, ja.
Ek weet ook dat jy kry ook een paneel wat die helfte is van die 96. Dit kos een klein bietjie meer aan die kant, maar dit maak nie een verskil aan die prijs rarig wat dan gevra word aan die verbruiker op die einde van die dag nie. Ek weet vir die beeste gebruik ons die 48 een op die oomblik by Unistel. Ons sal net maar moet uitvind in terme van die ou wine of daar ook een kleiner een die 48 ook beskikbaar is op die ou wine chat.
Ek wil net noem as julle in julle chatbox kyk, Chanel het 'n link gestuur wat van 'n produk wat Allflex het vir tissue sampling wat miskien handig sal wees om net na te kyk. Soos ek sê, is een link na Allflex. Ek weet nie, is daar nog miskien iemand wat ergens iets wil sê? Ons het daarom een paar dormer ouwens hier, sien ek. Ek weet nie van die ander rasse nie. Miskien moet die Merinos die inspiratie wees, dat ons kan verwys ons populaties dalk in die hande kry, en dan kan ons die diens ook miskien tot hulle beskikking stel. Willem, jy was ook stil vandag. Ek dink is tyd dat jy ook daarom iets sê van jou kant af.
Jaapie, kan ek net voordat Willem enig iets sê, kan ek net sê, as daar dormer ouwens is, volgens die goed wat Nelius ontleed het, dormers het natuurlijk een kleiner effectieve populatie groot is, om het ander woord, dat mense het by hulle waarschijnlijk minder dieren nodig om een verwysingspopulatie te begin. Dit is net iets wat hulle in gedagte kan hou later. Maar ja. In elk geval, dit is eigenlijk al wat ek wil sê, Willem, ek wil dit net sê voordat die gesprekkie van Jaapie oor die dormers te ver in die achtergrond gekom het.
Willem, het jy miskien iets? Ek hoop jy is wakker geblei, Willem, vir die hele tyd. Jy is net gemute. Hulle sê, dit is die ding wat die meeste oor Zoom gesê word. Dus jy is gemute.
Hallo Jaapie, nee, ek was van vinnig uit, kan jy gauw herhaal asjeblief?
Nee, ons wil net hê, jy moet iets sê, dis al, Willem. Het jy dalk, ja, een bydra of iets?
Nee, ek dink dis belangrik vir die ouwens dat ons in die richting beweeg, en die moment is ons gaan begin om die moeilik meetbare eigenskappe by te bring, en dit wat ons van die navorsingskuddes afbring, ek het reeds al met Greta en Pernice en Bobby gepraat oor die moontlikheid dat ons my navorsingskuddes se treksterkte waardes kan inbring. Om moontlike GBV's waardes daarvoor uit te kry vir teelers. Dis inligting wat binnen ons kuddes, navorsingskuddes is, wat nie noodwendig by baie van die teelers tot hulle beskikking is nie.
Ja, dis waar. Jy weet vraag wanneer die eerste evaluatie miskien gedoen gaan word. Bobby, miskien moet jy en Jason can maybe just elaborate on that, on the runs.
So we are currently putting in the genomic information within the blob. So we are moving to a single step G-blob evaluation on the moment. And we want to try to have the first GBVs available at the end of this year for the Merino and then for evaluation purposes and then hopefully we can move to implementation of genomic breeding values for the Merino early next year.
Is daar miskien nog iemand wat 'n bydrae wil lewer? Anders ons was so 'n bietjie oor 'n uur en 'n half besig gewees. Ek dink dit is goed.
Kan ek net
Kan ja, net, Greta, asseblief. Ja, asseblief.
Ek wil
ja.
net hoor, kyk, ons het ons nou die reference populatie in die biobank. Nee? Hoe lang moet ons nou nog met dit aangaan en hoe gaan dit nou verder aansluit by die genomic breeding wellies wat julle nou maak? En kyk, die wat julle ons nou gebruik, kom ons nou uit die reference populatie uit, die genotypes. So, hoe lang moet ons nou bijvoorbeeld nog aangaan met die industrie kuddes wat deel is van die reference populatie? Want ons versamel ons nou bloedmonsters elke jaar nog van al die nageslag wat gebore word. En op die oomblik is ons saam met Marina SA ook bezig om van die high impact sires bloedmonsters te versamel. So, as die mense nou vir julle die bloedmonsters gaan instuur, hoe lang moet ons nou nog aangaan met die reference populatie?
Greta, ek dink ons moet daai gesprek miskien voer. Dis vir my verskriklik belangrik dat die mens veral high impact diere en diere wat as goeie linksaaiers dien, laat die mens dit by julle moet bly mee volhou. Ek dink nie 'n mens moet sommer wegkom daarvan nie. Ek dink as 'n teeler op 'n punt kom op ek wil amper sê op kommersiële skaal die toetse wil doen, dan is het miskien ietsie anders, maar ek dink een mens moet met dit aangaan as het enigszins moontlik is, want jy weet, môre oor môre gaan ons oor dalk na een volgende stap van iets doen, en dit sal tragies wees as een mens jy weet, een verlies van dit het. Ek weet nie, dit is nou maar kort antwoord, maar ek dink, is miskien ja. Een goeie ding dat ons miskien om 'n tafel gaan sit en sorg dat die fasiliteit nie jy weet, kan aangaan, want ek dink ons moet dit definitief, ja.
Jaapie, dalk as ek net kan 'n bydrae maak hierso in terme van verwysingspopulasies, ek dink die 1000 genotypes is internasionaal die rule of thumb, en hulle sê, jy kan nie in die genomic GBV's vat, as jy nie tenminste 1000 diere het met genomiese profiele op, wat in die blap ingaan nie. Maar ek het gesien by van die vleisbeesrasse, dat alhoewel ons by 1000 verwysingspopulasie begin het om genomiese teelwaardes te publiseer, dat waar rasse op die oomblik hier by die 5000, oor die 5000 verwysingspopulasie kom, dan begin jy regtig sien dat daar een groter verbetering is in terme van akkuraathede, en so voort. So ek dink nou dat die ou oor die 1000 merk is, moet jy nie nou dink, okay, dit is nou klaar nie. Ek dink die ou moet nog steeds daai verwysingspopulasie probeer uitbou en weier maak. Soos om Skalk ook vroeër gesê het, is dat die Merino byvoorbeeld het 'n groter, hoe kan ek sê, basis of variasie binne in diere as byvoorbeeld ander rasse. En dit maak, en hoe groter daai variasie is, moet die ou seker maak dat jou verwysingspopulasie is verteenwoordigend van die variasie in die nasionale merino kudde. En daarom is het belangrik, Greta, laat die ou moet bly saamwerk om hierdie genomiese verwysingspopulasie uit te brei oor die 2000 merk wat ons oomblik na toe gaan.
Dis
reg, dankie. Ja, ek hoop net vinnig iets sê.
Ja, asseblief, Skalk.
Ek dink dit is ook afhankelijk maar van jou eienskap. Ek meen, jy het meer nodig vir laag oor erflike eienskappe. So ek dink nie, mens moet enigszins mik vir enig iets onder 5000 nie. Ek wil amper sê om mee te begin. Maar ek meen, ek dink ons kan binnen die volgende jare wat, kan ons oor die 3000 gaan, so met ander woorde, ek dink nie, dat die Elsenburg gedeelte van die monsters ook aangeneem op die ouwe. En so dit behoort, en kyk daar ewerskielik, dat is 5000 nie meer so ver.
Ja, ek sou ook dink, Greta, met dit wat jy in die biobank het, laat ons strategies dalk diere identificeer om te genotype ek is seker Merino SA of 'n paar ander ouens kan dalk, jy weet waar hulle 'n paar sent het, dit, ek meen, dit gaan nie noodwendige voordeel hê vir die teeler nie, want dit is net bydra tot die verwysingspopulasie, maar dit gaan vir die ras geweldig baie beteken as 'n mens dalk nog strategies diere kan kry en wat Bobby gesê het, veral daai diere wat jy vermoed geneties 'n bietjie verder afstand gewys van die res van die verwysingspopulasie is, sodat jy dit eintlik kan nouer intrek in jou matrix, jou verwys in jou verwantskap tussen diere. Ek weet nie, the breeders are quiet. Jeff, you were the only one that said something. I don't know if there's other breeders, enig van die teelers. Ek Peer het probeer, maar sy klank het nie gewerk nie. Ek weet nie of daar nog iemand is nie, anders Dani, ek weet nie of jy tevrede is, Dani, jy was deel van die reëling van dit. Is jy tevrede met dit? Ons eindig nog steeds op 46 deelnemers. Ek dink dit is uitstekend vir vandag. Dani.
Ek is tevrede, dankie Jaapie, dankie vir almal se bydraes.
Ja, dankie. As daar nie nog iets by is nie, dan kan ek maar sê tot ziens, behalwe as daar nog iemand is. Baie dankie vir julle tyd. Please Adrian. That's right.
Thanks so much for this opportunity. I want to thank you of Stambuk and all your panelists. You know, for us sort of just normal farmers that are grappling and interested in these subjects, you've put a lot of stuff out there, which I think is very important. And you know, a lot of information for us to sit down and work through now, guys that are interested in this. And I think, like you say, you know, the 50 people that have come on today, that's wonderful. I mean, to start this thing that you you know, this initiative with that, I think it can only grow. And you know, this question and answering thing can also develop with people that are interested. So, you know, from Marino SA, I'd like to thank you and your team, all the panelists, and our technical committee under Ras van Pletsen, who sort of, you know, initiated this thing. I hope this is the first of many. And thank you very much for all your inputs. I think it's greatly appreciated, and it, you know, can make this thing grow, and we can get some impetus behind the whole project.
Thanks, Adrian, and thanks for the platform as well. It's, you know, I just think one must always, you know, build the bridges between science on scientists on the one side and the practicality on the other, and that's important to us as well. Okay, thank you very much. Baie dankie vir julle tyd en sterkte vir die res van die dag en boerdery vir die ons wat met boerdery betrokke is. Goed gaan.